seated. We are gathered here this 8th day of July in the year 2021 at Hillsview E Free Church to celebrate the life of Jerry Friederich. And on behalf of Karen and the rest of Jerry's family, I welcome you for being here with us today. It is our hope and our prayer that we bring honor to an honorable man today and to glorify our Lord Jesus Christ. That glorifying of God is what Jerry would have insisted upon. Pray with me. Almighty God, the one who gives us life and the one who receives us in death, Lord, we thank you for your abiding presence and for the grace provided in Jesus Christ. Lord, in our frailty, we look to you for strength, and in our sorrow, we look to you for comfort. Lord, lead us in this hour to place our trust in you, that we may receive light and understanding and a new experience of your grace, a grace that promises eternal hope through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord, it is our prayer, again, that what we do and say and sing here today is pleasing in your sight, bringing honor to one of your children and glorifying of you through Jesus Christ. It is in his name we pray and trust you for the results. Amen.
Good morning. Jerry Dean Friederich, 68, passed away into glory on June 30th, 2021, in his home in Rapid City. Jerry was born on August 29th, 1952, in Parkston, South Dakota, to Victor and Bertha Friederich. Jerry graduated from Tripp High School in 1970 and from Mitchell Votech in 1972. He moved to Rapid City just before the big flood of 1972 and began working as an architectural draftsman and became involved with South Canyon Baptist Church. During a Bible study, he met a beautiful young woman who he would date and later marry. Jerry and Karen Peck were married June of 1976 and recently celebrated 45 years of marriage. He worked at several different jobs, including Hardco, Western Stationers, Friederich Ceramic Tile, and his final job back at Western Stationers as an in-town salesman, and he called on me. Because organization was a forte, founding various groups and programs was a special part of his life. Some of the groups include South Dakota Christian Homeschoolers, Western Dakota Christian Homeschoolers, Road and Water District for Qual Subdivision, various Bible studies, and Christian Financial Studies, helping with local missions projects, and Awana, and that should be the master of Awana. He also had a special love in keeping things clean and tidy, much to the joy and the chagrin of his family. He enjoyed working outside of his yard or garden and faithfully attended all the activities of his children throughout the years. Jerry was a loving husband, son, and father, and will be missed greatly by his wife, Karen Friederich, children Christy and Jason Burton of Virginia, Andrew and Abigail Friederich of California, and David Friederich of Washington, mother Bertha Friederich of South Dakota, brothers Alan Friederich and Randy Friederich, both of South Dakota, and Dennis Friederich of South Carolina, and sister Barbara Janice of Missouri, 11 grandchildren, and the other extended family members. He was preceded in death by his father, Victor Friederich. Karen, can I just have a moment? You know, the story of Jerry and Karen is a great picture of God's sovereignty to me. Here was a young man from the Tripp area of South Dakota. And if I have this right, there was a young girl who was a cheerleader in Huron, South Dakota. Is that correct? Do I have that right? Not cheerleader? Anyway, God took these two and made a beautiful tool for him to use. It was all a part of his plan that these two should show up in a Bible study at Little South Canyon Baptist Church from two different areas, didn't know each other, and God created something special. Well, I was right there for all of it. I was 13 years old when Jerry came to town. And right in way, I knew he was something special. We had an amazing youth group and college age group at that time. And, you know, we seemed to be more like a big family than groups. I can remember that the Eric's boys and the Odegaard boys and Jerry, they would always include this little guy to go along with all the activities that happened Sunday night after church. We had great times. And they taught me so much about and helped me shape my life to where I am today. Well, the news of their engagement went viral, even though there was no social media. Everybody was so excited. And I saw the picture on there, the old red shag carpet of South Canyon Baptist, right? Who can forget that? But through the years, I watched Jerry offer himself to God for his service. Another great impression on me. But Jerry had one major defect, one major fault, and I could never help him with it. He was a Dallas Cowboy fan, of all things. Well, this humble servant of God is now home with his Lord. Whenever a Christ follower leaves this world, I do try and imagine what it would be like. Can you imagine Jerry's first breath of celestial air that happened right after his last breath of earthly air? And then just to stop and think about what he saw. Amazing. And that's something that we as Christ followers have to look forward to. But I can bet one of the first things he wanted to do was to see the face of his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Well done, Jerry, thou good and faithful servant. I'm going to ask you to stand, and we're going to sing together that great hymn of the faith, Amazing Grace. Oh, can you turn the piano on, please? There we go.
Thank you, Bob. Now I'm going to read a scripture from 1 Chronicles 29, 11 through 12. This was a favorite of Jerry's, and it's from David's prayer, where it says David was praying to the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly. And he says this in verse 11. He says, "Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor. For everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and to give strength to all. To begin this morning, let me thank you, Karen and Christy, at watching Andy and David and Bertha and your families and all the grandchildren and the brothers and the sister, extended family and friends of Jerry. It is an honor to stand before you today and to speak at this celebration of life. It is, and we've already prayed, it is our hope, my hope today, to honor Jerry Friederich, his life, his legacy, and to glorify God. And with men like Jerry, that's not hard to do. He was an honorable man whose purpose in life was to bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. Jerry would tell you today is a good day, and is a good day for you and a great day for him. The week before Jerry's passing last week, I sat in his living room, and he was struggling to keep food down, to keep food in due to the cancer. And I asked him, I said, Jerry, is this a bad day in that regard? And he quickly corrected me, saying, there were no more bad days in his life. A good day was if he woke up and had another day with Karen and his family and his friends. And a great day is if he didn't wake up and he was in the presence of Jesus Christ, his Savior. I'm sitting in that living room and I'm amazed at the grace of God, at how our Lord gives people the strength, the patience, the wisdom, the right perspective in times like that. Here I was sitting on the other side of the couch, on the other side of cancer, thinking, what would I say? What would I do? How would I be handling this? Hoping that when it's my turn, that God would give me the grace to get through it. This same grace that Jerry displayed, this same right perspective on life, the same outlook. I want it now, don't you? Jerry reminded me, he reminded us that in Christ Jesus, in the family of God, there are no bad days. In Christ, there are good days and there are great days. Jerry became a Christian as a child. He was, and this is awesome how God works this all out. He was saved at a VBS, at a vacation Bible school, at the age of 8 or 9 years old, back where he grew up, where Bob talked about. When I told the family that we would be here at Hillsview, be decorated for our VBS this week, they thought it was wonderful. What a great tie-in. Again, the display of God's goodness. A God that Jerry clearly understood, as Bob said, is as sovereign. A God that is in control. The verses that I read from earlier, 1 Chronicles 29:11 through 12, they are not, that's not a common life verse or section of scripture for many. But like Christy said, his daughter said to me the other day, it is not a common verse that brings a lot of comfort or day-to-day direction or reminder, but it fits her dad. It fits Jerry to a T. It talks of our Lord's greatness and power, his majesty and splendor, about how everything is his. He is overall, and he provides what we need when we need it. Jerry had a healthy understanding that God is sovereign. Back in May of 2020, 14 months ago, he was diagnosed with stomach cancer. And he called me to let me know and asked the church to be praying for him and his family. And in that conversation, he told me that he was trusting God. He was trusting God's will, knowing that if he, Jerry, had all the facts that only God has, if he could see the whole picture, only what God sees, Jerry said he would do exactly the same thing as God was doing in his life. Already the grace of God being displayed. And he told me that his only concern was for Karen and for his family, that they would have obvious concern and angst for him. He trusted God, though. He wanted to be in God's will. Jerry had a wonderful testimony. Throughout his life, he made himself available to be used by our Lord for his work and for his purpose, almost exactly what Bob said. In the obituary read earlier, we heard of his help with Christian homeschoolers, with assorted Bible studies, with Christian financial studies, and the Awana ministry, which, again, was especially precious to him, dear to him. Participating in that ministry, training and teaching, and even leading it regionally as a commander for many years. That's where I first met Jerry. God used Jerry in his gifting and in his own personality and passions. God used him in areas where details matter and discipline is required. The Awana verse, the verse of scripture that the Awana ministry uses as its core is 2 Timothy 2:15, where the Apostle Paul talks to his student Timothy saying, "Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." And it's easy to see, if you knew Jerry, why or how that verse fits him to a T as well. Jerry was diligent in everything that he did. He was a worker, a leader, yes, but he led by example. And not just in ministry-related activity. If you were a customer of or a co-worker of Jerry's, you know his dedication to doing work, the work right and timely and even generously. He was a worker and he was a man above reproach, a man of integrity. He gave no reason to be ashamed. A faithful husband of over 45 years, a loving dad and grandpa, a loyal brother, son, friend. Jerry loved the Awana ministry because it emphasized the Word of God, and he wanted to see children grow up rightly dividing it. Rightly dividing in the Greek language means to cut straight. Jerry wanted children to start young handling the Word of God with precision and care as only a master craftsman would use, and as he would in his or her with her materials. The tile and granite business was perfect for Jerry, wasn't it? A man of precision and all about cutting straight. A man that applied the Word of God to his finances, to his work, to his health, his well-being, his hobbies, and to his family. Again, Jerry and Karen were married for over 45 years, raising three children together, all about 4 or 5 years apart. 9 years between Christy, the oldest, and David, the youngest. I put in parentheses, that's one of the ways to stay young and active, spread them out, right? Jerry and Karen made all the concerts and recitals for Christy, all the gymnastic meets for Andy, all the games at Rap City Christian for David. It was a given. Freddie's, that's what they called David at Rap City Christian, Freddie's parents are always here, always there. They always show up. It was said by others. I also learned this week that, and this didn't surprise me a bit, that Jerry was not the fun dad type. He would play, he would teach and train his kids, he would toss the ball, throw the frisbee, teach you how to bat, but Karen was the fun parent. And that, by the way, completely reversed, completely flipped when Jerry became a grandpa. All of a sudden, I think all of his grandpas get this, Jerry became the game-playing, fun-loving grandparent, no longer having to train, no longer having to teach, but just enjoying the grandchildren and letting them enjoy him. Jerry had 11 grandchildren and one on the way. The last grandchild that he met, and he was really excited about this next one coming, Andy, right? But the last one he met, the latest one was named Naomi Hope. But the family, everyone in the family, calls her Epi, short for epilogue, okay? Christy and her husband thought they were done having kids. They thought that part of their story was over, but God had other plans for them. Naomi is an epilogue of sort. They laugh while saying that. Well, the definition of an epilogue, and I looked this up, is a concluding section that rounds out the design of a literary work. It's the final scene of a play that comments on or summarizes the main action. It's the afterword, maybe the postscript. And isn't that what this is today? Isn't that what we do at these celebrations of life ceremonies? We, after the story is complete, after the life has been lived, don't we in these funerals try to sum it all up, right? Try to round out the design of the person being celebrated and then buried? This today is the epilogue of Jerry Friederich. He has lived his life out here on earth, and we are trying to sum up that life. But here's the thing. Jerry's life, Jerry's abundant life, began when he was 8 or 9 at a vacation Bible school in Tripper, Parkston, South Dakota, and will go on for eternity. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Jerry is having a great day. And every day in heaven is a great day. A bad day is not an option in heaven. Neither is a good day. They're all great. And do you know why that is true? If you go back to the verse from Paul to Timothy where he said, be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Jerry is in heaven today having a great day, not because he was diligent, not because he was a good worker, not because he led a life above reproach, not even because he rightly divided the word of God, not because he was a faithful husband or a great dad or a fun grandpa or a loyal brother or friend, but because, do you see the word approved there? Because he was approved by God. Jerry was approved. He was made righteous in the eyes of God when he accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. Jesus was approved by the mercy and the grace of God, not for any other reason other than his belief in our Lord Jesus Christ. Jerry was a man that confessed with his mouth that Jesus was Lord and believed in his heart that God raised him from the dead. Jerry placed his salvation and his soul into the hands of Jesus Christ, admitting that he was a sinner, in need of a Savior, and he did that as a child. And ladies and gentlemen and kids that are here, Jerry, no matter his relationship to you, friend or family, he would love to have you see the same need of a Savior as well. He would love to have you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. So when the epilogue of your lives are written, when it's your turn and when it's our turn to face the end of our time on this earth, that the same could be said of you and me, that our eternal life has no ending, that we are reunited with those that have gone before us because we believe in Jesus Christ and are approved in him. To a God that loves us so much that he sent his only begotten Son to earth, right? To suffer greatly, to die on a cross for the atonement of our sins, for the forgiveness of our sins, to be raised 3 days later in the newness of life, resurrection life. Jerry would beseech you to believe. He would want you to hear this clearly and to act on this today. If you need to talk this over with me or any other Christian in this room, do so today before leaving. I would love to pray with you. Again, Karen, family, friends, thank you. Please know that you're being prayed for a peace and a calm and a comfort that only our Lord can provide. And you know not to hesitate to call us if we can be helpful in any other way. Jerry will be missed, and I am thankful and grateful to have ministered with him and to him. Amen.
Well, we're going to close our service out by singing a very familiar hymn. It is Well With My Soul. At the fourth verse, I'm going to ask Bobby to quit playing because I love to hear the family of God singing this great hymn. And so let's stand as we get ready to conclude this service. It is Well With My Soul.
Yeah.
sing this fourth verse. And Lord, haste the day when my face shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound and the Lord shall descend. God's people said, let's remain standing.
Remain standing for the little closing prayer. We'll pray here. Pray with me. Again, Lord. Lord, we pray, we ask you for comfort and peace this day. Lord, we thank you and praise you again for those here gathered, for the encouragement that they bring to their family of Jerry Friederich. But we pray for those here gathered that mourn the loss of Jerry as well, Lord. Lord, wrap your arms around them. Give them fond memories of him. Give us a faith to look forward to the future with hope and confidence and courage. And my prayer, Lord, is our prayer, is that we would draw closer to you in times like these, Lord, on days like this. Lord, have your way with this man's family and friends, and we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. You're all invited to stay for there's going to be a meal right now, and we're going to be out at Pine Lawn for the internment at 1:30 as well. So thank you for being here. God bless you.
We invite you to enjoy us for lunch. The lines are open for the food, and hopefully you're blessed by the meal today. Thank you.